So today we will briefly go through cardio-oncology. Cardio-oncology, the heart really matters, echocardiography at the fore. I will try to bring together several things in this 45-minute interactive session that we will have, and try to tell you how I got interested in it in the first place. So cardio-oncology, a new specialty. Close interaction between two specialties was required for the optimal care of many patients with cancers. Recognition of cardiac complications of various cancers, recognition of pre-existing CVD in cancer patients, and in early recognition of cardiac complications of cancer drugs. When I moved from my previous institution, which was a single specialty hospital, and when we built the Medanta, which was a multi-specialty, that's where I first came in touch with patients. And this was a double whammy because many patients who had heart disease developed cancers, and those who had cancers actually became prey to cardiac LV dysfunction. So there were cardiovascular risk factors, there's disease, there's treatment-related cardiotoxicity. So to me, several years ago, it really appeared to be a baffling field. As a person who's in the cath lab, in the echo lab, a clinical cardiologist, and then my colleagues from the two areas of radiation and medical oncology would, and then I realized that we have an important duty to these patients. And this is how it evolved. So we formed a team. So our team is a group of people with a full set of complementary skills required to complete a task or a job or a project, or as I added, save a patient. And the team members are interdependent. They share authority and responsibility. They're accountable for collective performances, and they work towards a common goal. This is extremely important. To me, this was very, very important, that I would not want a patient of coming to me with a cancer issue saying, yeah, I'm to cancer ke liye aaye the, see, this is what we've got, or that they develop more diffidence. One has to understand that anybody with these two tags, cancer and cardiac, are already emotionally under great stress. Thus, a team generates performance greater than the sum of the performance of all its individual members. So way back in 2013, with Dr. Trehan, we formed a team called the Multidisciplinary Heart Team. This was the heart team approach, in which we have a cardiothoracic surgeon, a structural heart specialist, and a non-implanting physician. And this is exactly how the multidisciplinary cardio-oncology team came into existence, which consists of a medical radiation oncologist, a clinical cardiologist who's fully who in the know of heart failure, acute care cardiology, arrhythmias, and AFib, and a very pertinent and well-defined echocardiologist who could tell us the whole nuance of ejection fraction and also of, and you will see how many things evolved on the echo front on this, and also support teams from both the departments. So this is how the team is. You know, the person has just snipped a ball and you see how many people are ready to take the catch. And that's where, amongst other teams in our realm of medical sciences, and you are seeing in the current era also how so many people are working together. This is cardio-oncology. Let me start straight with the case history. 45 years old lady, diagnosed with invasive ductal carcinoma of the breast, no other comorbidities, received epirubicin for 3 months. Now the oncology team plans to start trastuzumab, referred to cardiology for baseline cardiac evaluation. And that's what we are at Medanta. Our people, our oncologists will refer to us patients for a baseline evaluation. So as you can see, before trastuzumab, the LVEF was 61%. And very importantly, global longitudinal strain, and we'll come to that in a little while, made such a big difference to the way we were picking up LV dysfunctions. Here the GLS was minus 22, quite normal. But just see what happens after 3 months. The LVEF is still normal. I mean, what is the difference between 60 and 61? But look at what has happened to the global longitudinal strain. The global longitudinal strain is now 18.7, and you can see the areas. See, in the strain pattern, you can actually put the heart in 17 segments as we do in nuclear, when the nuclear medicine report comes in. So you can almost see that in the posterior wall, you can see some problem, and the GLS in this patient is minus 18.7%. After 3 months of trastuzumab, LVEF, no significant reduction, GLS was reduced to 18.67%, and then 16% patients were started on beta blockers. Beta blockers, and I will come to that, are supposed to be a lycase inhibitors and statins, cardioprotective. Because see, this patient has not come for a cardiac disease. He should not live with a cardiac disease just because he or she received a chemotherapy. So early detection is important. So during chemotherapy, then we almost got the GLSS to minus 19. The patient was statins and beta blockers. 1 year after completion of therapy, no change at all. The patient was sent back home normal. Continue. Another case, 53 years old lady diagnosed with metastatic adenocarcinoma of the lung. She was known hypertensive. Now, many a drug which is given in cardio oncology causes or increases hypertension. She had completed 4 months of a drug, now complained of shortness of breath. Oncology team planned to start a carboplatin Q3 weekly, referred to cardiology for cardiac evaluation. Here you can see, this is the ejection fraction. Pretty normal. GLS, quite normal, minus 22, minus 23 are normal. You can see all the segments are seen as V, whether you see anteroceptor, anterior, lateral, posterior, inferior, all the segments were negative. Did have some problems, and even the Doppler was fine. The only thing that we found was that E by E prime was actually more than 15, and that demonstrates to you the fact that the patient has got increased LVEF. So the patient mild increase in LVEDP. So LVEF, there was no significant reduction. GLS, there was no significant reduction, but the patient had diastolic dysfunction. So it's not that we are just looking at echo ejection fraction and going through the GLS and saying people can also develop diastolic dysfunction. Mind you, this patient was already a hypertensive patient, and they had full distinct that diastolic dysfunction could have increased. So the patient was advised regular echocardiography for diastolic function. 29 years old lady diagnosed with leukemia, no other comorbidities, received chemotherapy. And when she first came to us, to our onco team, her ejection fraction was already 45%. And this is exactly what I'm saying, that a patient who had some other problem now develops a cardiac issue. Oncology team planned to give chemotherapy again, and they referred to us for cardiac evaluation. This time, I thought that ejection fraction they've already given us 45. I thought I will do a dobutamine echo. And as you can see, in dobutamine echo, this is the at start, and this is low dose, this is max dose, and this is in recovery. And you can see that in all these, she was found to have a normal, nearly normal ejection fraction. Again, in the four chamber position, you can see the EF appeared to be almost normal, and in the short axis view as well. So she completed a full dobutamine echo. My reading was that as the ejection fraction has gone up from 45 to almost 60 in this patient, we could just continue with the chemotherapy that would save her life. So many a times we not only use global longitudinal strain, we not only use diastolic functional parameters, we not only use LA size, we also use a dobutamine echo to reassure our oncology colleagues that they can go ahead with the therapy for which the patient had actually come to them for. So after one cycle of chemotherapy, the LVEF reported outside was 45%, cardioprotective medications were started, DSC done showed an improvement in LV function to 55%, she had good contractile reserve, and hence chemotherapy was continued with close monitoring of left ventricular ejection fraction. Then of course you can see here the non-bacterial NBT in a patient with CA lung. You can see very clearly the red arrow on the right side. You can see a good three-dimensional view of the mitral valve, and this was a non-bacterial endocarditis, so nothing had to be done in this patient. Look at this. This patient had a cardiac metastasis from a CA tongue, and you can see that there's hardly any space in. So not only do we get myxomas of the heart, not only do we get metastasis in the heart, particularly the pericardium, but also we get directly affected because of the cancer chemotherapy and the cancer itself. So shifting gears here, with this background, and this was my first interaction with patients from the onco side, I realized that cancer and cardiac illnesses many cancers affect the heart directly, and many cancer therapies produce cardiotoxicity. So both sentences were correct. And some of my patients had already pre-existing disease. And they said, look, sir, we've already had a bypass procedure done. Now we have got another problem. Will we survive or not survive? So pre-existing CVD worsens cancer outcomes. And pre-existing CVD also increases the risk of chemotherapy-mediated cardiotoxicity. So which means that we are not treading on thin ice. We're treading on science. We are saying that, yes, you have a problem. But yes, there are therapies. There are people. There is a team which will look at how much therapy to be given. There is a team which will say, yes, these are the cardiac medications which I would like to add as well. But I want you to go through what you had actually come for, and that was cancer. So if you look at the cardiotoxicity of cancer drugs, just in a broad way, you can get LV systolic dysfunction, you can get myocardial ischemia, you can get arrhythmias, pericarditis, and thrombophilia. And the LV systolic dysfunction, some of the drugs are anthracyclines, monoclonal antibodies, tyrosine kinase inhibitors. Myocardial ischemia can be caused by 5-fluorosyl-like agents, tyrosine kinase inhibitors. Pericarditis, very common with cyclophosphamide, and arrhythmias with arsenic and other indirect agents. Meaning thereby that the team has to be solid. You have to have a full view of it's not just doing an echo which will matter, but it's putting everything together. And many times these people come with atrial fibrillation because the LA sizes have increased. So LA strain will become very important. So myocardial toxicity, then we can say type 1 leads to myocardial necrosis. Dose-related, usually irreversible, doxorubicin, epirubicin, these are some of the examples. And type 2, there's not really myocardial necrosis, only myocardial dysfunction, not related to dose, usually reversible. And example is trastuzumab, very, very commonly used in our patients. So we will have to look at lifestyle risk factors. We will have to look at demography and other risk factors. That is very important. The things on your right side are very important. Is he a person currently smoking? Does he take high alcohol intake? Until and unless you bring down the risk factors as much as you possibly can, we are in trouble both from the LV function side as well as from the side of actually the cancer and the bypass, and the cancer and the heart disease. Current myocardial disease, heart failure, asymptomatic LV dysfunction, evidence of CAD, moderate to severe valvular heart disease, patient may be having aortic stenosis, hypertensive heart disease, So clinically, you have to fully diagnose your condition. What has the patient come for? He has been referred to me for cancer chemotherapy. What am I up against? What is the patient up against? What? And then you make your own chart and say, look, lifestyle risk factors, these are your current myocardial factors, and therefore this is your risk. And the Mayo Clinic has given a very good score of the overall risk of cardiotoxicity, and they call it a CRS, or an overall risk by cardiotoxicity can be defined by the CRS. And here, high risk, you already give them four. These are medication-related risk, anthracycline, cyclophosphamide. Intermediate, you have sunitinib. As I told you, these tinibs increase blood pressure. Then you have low risk, you have leptinib. You give them a score of one. And then you have rare, for example, rituximab and things like that. And then you have patient-related risk factors, cardiomyopathy or heart failure, CAD or equivalent, hypertension, diabetes, controlled, not controlled, prior or concurrent anthracycline. So you can, if your score is six and above, then your overall cardiovascular risk is high. If it is between 5 to 6, it is high. 3 to 4, it is intermediate. 1 to 2, it's low. And 0, of course, very low. So this actually gives you an idea of what you are up against. This is risk assessment in patients receiving chemotherapy. Similarly, monitoring recommendations. And these are very clear. Very high cardiotoxicity risk, transthoracic echocardiography with strain before every cycle or every other cycle. And that's why I emphasized why the team is important. Because you have to talk to somebody and say, look, gentlemen, do you want to continue the same or do you want to have me do an echo before you start the next cycle? Because the patient has a very high cardiotoxicity risk. And then you come to high cardiotoxicity risk, wherein you do a transthoracic echo with strain every 3 cycles, or as the 3 cycles end, 3 to 6 months, or a year after chemotherapy. Then you have intermediate cardiotoxicity risk. Then you have those who have low. So for each section of people, for each area of risk, very high, high, intermediate, and low, there is something available to you. And therefore, until and unless you do not talk to each other, you will not know if the patient is getting the maximum benefit or not. The management recommendations, and I will come to those, but are very clear. You initiate ACE inhibitors, ARBs, carvedilol, statins, starting at the lowest dose, and start the chemotherapy in 1 week after initiation of, to allow steady state. In those who have cardiotoxicity, high cardiotoxicity risk, initiate ACE and ARBs, carvedilol and statins. Intermediate risk, you discuss the risk and benefit of medications. Look, low and very low, only monitoring is required, nothing else is required. So if you look at this simple 2 pages of risk assessment and how will you monitor, your whole basis of cardio-oncology rests on these. And as we go locally, we've got our own charts, we've got our own this thing, but basically these things help us in the patient achieving the goal of having come with a cancerous condition to actually get the full treatment. Just as when a patient comes to us with acute myocardial infarction, we give them the full treatment, either it is pharmacoinvasive or it is a primary angioplasty, but we will do a full job. That's exactly what these people are asking you for. So sometimes I've also seen that long-term survivors of childhood cancer have a greater than 8-fold increased risk of CV mortality, and sometimes they get heart failure and strokes. And that is the reason why it is said that maybe after a year of stopping or after 6 months, you can repeat the echo. So the key, truly, truly, the key is detection of the disease early and prevention. So along with your clinical thinking, along with your formation of a team, you will get a lot of information from echocardiography. And this is an important slide. Why? Because this tells you about phenotyping and prognostic assessment, how the role of echocardiography will help you in the evaluation of these patients, and then additional markers. For example, the Mayo Clinic team has written very clearly, they also do pro-BNPs and other tests along just to see what the dysfunction is. But if you look at just what echocardiography can give you, then from the very first slide, as you can see, you can get LV volumes and ejection fraction. Those of us who have a 3D echo, we can get a real good 3D LV volumes in EF. And these are important. See, if you look at it, these are important because these will tell us something which later on may be confirmed by global longitudinal strain, but these should move hand in hand. So we have done the LV volumes and ejection fraction. We have got LV myocardial deformation. We have got LV dystrophy. Also importantly, we have functional MR. We can assess that. We can look at how much is the LV EDP. We can look at diastolic dysfunction. And from a tricuspid jet, we can find out the PA pressures and we can look at the RV function. So this in totality, apart from the biomarkers, will also give us full phenotyping and prognostic assessment. And this is important. You can actually, even with LA strain, you will be able to say that how many of these patients may actually be have a chance of getting atrial fibrillation. And these are important, that by a carefully performed transthoracic echocardiogram with deformation imaging, if you have a 3D with 3D volumes and a good LA size, good PA pressures, you can get a lot of information as to how you take this patient along and how you allow or say, look, please kindly wait for some time before you do start the next cycle. Strain imaging method has rapidly evolved as an important technique to actually quantitatively estimate global and or regional myocardial mechanical contractile function, and this can detect early subclinical LV dysfunction. This is important. This is extremely important because even before the LV ejection fraction starts to decrease, you will actually have defined that no, the LVEF is already known. And that's exactly what we do in patients of asymptomatic severe aortic stenosis. They say, look, we are asymptomatic. Our ejection fraction is fine. Why are you saying that we should have a valve surgery or a TAVI procedure? Well, if the global longitudinal strain rate imaging is already 16 or 15, then your myocardium is already jeopardized. And then this is the best way to go. That is exactly what we are doing when we deal with patients of different types of cancers, as I have said. So 2D strain by speckle tracking echocardiography becomes the very basis on which we look at patients very carefully. We do speckle tracking. We look at exactly what is the ejection fraction, and we also look at the global longitudinal strain. Here it is minus 22. We are comfortable with that. This is how it is done. Most good labs today will comfortably do. Now, here is a patient, he's just 22 years old. So you see, look at the irony of the whole thing. The person is just 22, he's got a cancer. You are going to give medication receiving the cancer therapy. Our EF is global longitudinal strain from minus 19.5 has come to minus 10.1. Well, we have given her another disease. Now she's a cardiomyopathy patient, or she's likely to become. So that is the reason why this onco team should be able to help many patients in not getting these issues. So before chemotherapy, here's another individual, 18.5. Just after chemotherapy, not so bad, but minus 16.5 is the peak systolic strain. There are three types of strains, but let me just say that the global longitudinal strain has been found to be the most pertinent in cardiology practice of today. So it is said that global longitudinal strain 15% relative percentage reduction from baseline value suggests cardiotoxicity. It's as clear as that. And this is not a very complex chart. I hate to show charts in meetings, but this is very, very clear. If the LVEF is below 50, hold treatment and repeat the EF in 3 weeks with cardioprotective drugs, and then you go ahead. If the LVEF is more than 50%, start treatment. If the LVEF falls 10%, or if the global longitudinal strain falls, then you can stop it for a while, you can give the medication, and you can resume treatment. And thus comes the importance of a teamwork wherein everybody has only one goal, and that goal is to save this person from the ravages of cardiac disease when the he or she. So, and this is a regression model in identifying subsequent cardiovascular effects, clinical variables plus LVEF. But the minute you add clinical variables, LV ejection fraction, you add global longitudinal strain, immediately your values improve. You can save your patients, you can pick up the patients far earlier, and you can identify patients who are likely to have a problem because of the use of the chemotherapeutic agents or the radiation therapy. So, which is a great thing. I mean, it doesn't mean you will stop the treatment. Your team will still give it, but they'll give it in a modified way, or they will. So this is from JACE, the Journal of American Study of Echocardiography, 2016, incremental value of LVEF and GLS by nested logistic regression models in identifying subsequent side effects. So there you are. There is enough data in this field. So my good friend, Dr. Tom Marwick, has done a lot of work in myocardial deformation imaging. And this is that one article, use of deformation imaging to detect preclinical myocardial dysfunction before conventional measures in patients undergoing breast cancer treatment with trastuzumab. So this was published in the American Heart Journal in the year 2000. But after that, there have been a lot of publications, and I will share with you some of them. So myocardial deformation identifies preclinical myocardial dysfunction earlier than the conventional measures in women undergoing treatment with trastuzumab for breast cancer. This is what briefly this article showed. And actually, after reading and others, this was 2009, I was convinced that we have in our tools enough to actually tell our colleagues how to go about it, what medications and things. So prediction of cancer chemotherapy mediated cardiotoxicity, now you have number of publications in the best journals across the world. Fall in GLS has had the greatest incremental value. There is no doubt. As of today, an 8% relative reduction is not meaningful, but a more than 15% relative reduction is significant. Now, in the patients without baseline strain measurements, a proposed cutoff is minus 19%. But if there is a reduction to 15%, then you know, you are sure that there's already LV dysfunction going on, even though ejection fraction may be 55%. Assessment of LV diastolic function, again, evaluation of mitral inflow pattern and measurement of early diastolic mitral annulus velocity, E prime by tissue Doppler, gives you an important sign. It tells you about LV filling pressures, and a left atrial volume estimation, pulmonary artery systolic pressure estimated from tricuspid regurgitation jet and pulmonary vein flow. All these will give you left atrial volume estimation. See, non-invasively, we should try to get as much information as possible that gives us a handle on this person's cardiac parameters, and that will help our team in continuing or not of the medication. Valve abnormalities can occur in due to neoplastic infiltration, non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis, and I showed you an example of NBTE, and of course, infective. All these things you can find out. Functional regurgitation due to ventricular dysfunction, as well as due to the effects of radiotherapy and some chemotherapeutic agents, can all be defined, and proper medication can be given so that the person goes through what he actually came to the hospital for, that is fulfilling the needs of chemotherapeutic agents. Right heart assessment, don't take it lightly. Anthracyclines have been shown to cause a decrease in RV systolic and diastolic functions. Now, most good labs will actually spend 15 minutes, 10 minutes extra, but will also take out RV systolic function. And you can then put this data in your HIS, and as the patient comes, you can find out visual 2D estimation of RVEF. You can also find out RV diastolic dysfunction. And of course, one of the things that we use very commonly is tricuspid annular systolic velocity measurement, and that TDI, and that's very, very important. So you can get RV size in plaques, sacs, and 4C views, and measurements you can take. You can take the RV end diastolic area and the end systolic area, and you will get a fractional shortening. You can get tricuspid excursion of systolic excursion of tricuspid annulus, and a measure of RV systolic function is derived through M-mode. You can do all these things, and you can do an RV strain. So once you have a patient, you don't have to inject anything. You don't have to put a tube in the person. You can get to know their prognosis absolutely, right side, left side, LA, everything you can come to know. So in HERS2 plus breast cancer treated with trastuzumab with or without anthracycline, who experienced cardiotoxicity based on reduction in LVF, concomitant RV dysfunction was also seen in up to 40% of the patients based on RV strain measurements. So that's important. And that's a good example of right ventricular systolic longitudinal strain. A is the control, B is the RV dysfunction in cardiotoxicity. Pericardial involvement, yes. In fact, one of the articles I read in Circulation said that if there is an involvement of the pericardium, it definitely shows that the cancer is neoplasm, is far gone. Can manifest as pericarditis, pericardial effusion, constrictive pericarditis, cardiac temperament. Many a times we are asked to help these patients in cardiac temperament. Here again, echocardiography is supreme in telling you exactly, is it RV collapse or not collapse? Is there a, how much is the pericardial tamponade? All these things. Takotsubo-like syndrome has also been seen in cancer patients treated with immune checkpoint inhibitors, and you can easily find that out by echocardiography. So, truly, there would be no purpose in screening if there were no therapeutic implications. I mean, there would be no point in saying, look, I'm sorry, your global longitudinal strain is minus 15. The patient says, look, what are you going to do about it? So there would be no purpose in screening if there were no therapeutic implications. And I'll come to that in a minute, but first let me spend a minute on pathophysiological links between cancer and cardiovascular disease. Age, gender, genetics, tobacco, diabetes, all these things. And the reason I say this is that you have to treat all these conditions. And there's also a synergistic opportunity in the interplay between cancer screening and cardiovascular disease risk assessment. And canakumab, the CANTO study, canakumab anti-inflammatory thrombosis outcome study, an important role of innate immunity in both atherosclerosis cancer was uncovered, where specific targeting of interleukin-1 beta conferred cardiovascular benefit and a dramatic decrease in lung cancer incidence. So this is Circulation 2018, and I'm sure someone somewhere is working on these conditions. So coming back to therapies, and the reason I wanted to spend a minute on the commonality of these is the fact that if you want to any strategy to reduce chemotherapy-induced cardiotoxicity, you will have to actually treat their the basic condition that they have. So all chemotherapy drugs, potential cardioprotective measures, you can identify and treat cardiovascular risk factors, treat comorbidities. If there's QTc prolongation and there's a possibility of cut after a certain point, avoid QT prolonging drugs. Anthracycline analogs, you can limit. This is something which I will not like to speak about, but my colleagues do that. But I would say that ACE inhibitors, ARBs, beta blockers, wherever indicated, and in least dose, we can start because these are cardioprotective agents. ACE1 prevent cardiotoxicity with cancer drugs, prevention of high-dose chemotherapy-induced cardiotoxicity in high-risk patients by angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitors, circulation 2016, amazing article, and you can give these drugs. This is beta blockers prevent cardiotoxicity with cancer. Trastuzumab therapy showed significant association with incident heart failure independent of anthracycline-related cardiotoxicity. So you can use these drugs wherever indicated. This again is from Dr. Tom Marwick's group, and it was published in Circulation Heart Failure. And I find this very useful because many of these people, many of these patients actually have a tachycardia, and a small dose of beta blocker will anyway be helpful. But here, beta blockers will also help prevent cardiotoxicity with cancer drugs. Enalapril and carvedilol for preventing chemotherapy-induced left ventricle systolic dysfunction in patients with malignant hemopathies. This is the OVERCOME trial, and this has been found to be useful. And lots of other people are also talking about the same things. Statins are just unbelievable drugs, prevent cardiotoxicity with cancer drugs. It is said so, but you know, many people have skepticism, but there is emerging data that this can also be. And this was an initial study that we did several years ago when we started our program, and we took patients, male, female, age groups, comorbidities, and we then, after this, we have a lot more cancer drugs. So we have now instituted cancer chemotherapeutic drugs, cardiac drugs that can help against cancer chemotherapy. So heart disease and cancers, in the end, ladies and gentlemen, I read this very nice perspective article in Circulation. Heart disease and cancers, are the two killers colluding? There are common molecular pathways, chronic inflammation and oxidative stress, and they both play a central role in the pathophysiology of cardiovascular disease and cancer. And just as we may say that there are common molecular pathways, oxidative stress and inflammation, there are also actually opportunities by which combined screening and prevention of these is possible. For example, somebody said, low dose, I'm sending my patient for low dose chest CT for some problem. Well, the preventive cardiologist says, well, why not just do a CAG score as well? Similarly, the patient is going for a cardiac CT, current CSC score for CVD risk assessment, you can also look at lung cancer detection with an additional lung window. So there are opportunities for combined screening, as one has read previously, that physical exercise, good diet, all these things, if you are doing for risk reduction in cardiovascular disease, you will also have 20% less cancer. So there is, so obesity, cigarette smoking is, of course, the biggest curse. Low level of physical activity, all these are combined, can be combined in primordial prevention. So shared secondary prevention, personalized screening adjustments for early cancer detection, informing CVD risk assessment, all these are possible if you think of the two C's, the cardiovascular disease and actually cancers. So ladies and gentlemen, I would say in these 45 minutes, what we've done is, and please feel free to talk to me, what do you feel? Cardio-oncology, the multidisciplinary cardiovascular cancer, multidisciplinary care of cancer patients has been proposed as a new approach to improve prevention, early identification. To me, that is the most important thing, and management of cardiotoxicity. And I'm not only just concentrating on cardiac toxicity in the sense that obviously many cancers also cause directly myocardial damage. Much of the focus has been in the early detection and prevention of heart failure. Cancer therapies are associated with a broad range of cardiovascular toxicities, including cardiac arrhythmias, systemic hypertension, and ischemic heart disease. I just added to this conclusion that echocardiography is critical to every step, because from diastolic dysfunction to LA size to LA strain to ejection fraction, it is our third eye, and that's how I feel that the team should include somebody who's well versed in all modern techniques of echocardiography. So with these words, ladies and gentlemen, I would say one team, one goal, every life priceless. Every life priceless. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, sir. I think it was indeed a founding session. And as we've discussed, we will continue to build the intensity on this particular topic. On that note, can we start taking questions, sir?
Sure, of course.
So the first question that I have is from Dr. Dipanjan. He's asking role of MRI in myocardial function monitoring and detection of metastasis.
Yeah, I did not speak about CT and MRI for only this reason, that I was talking about bedside techniques, which are giving us plenty of information. But of course, for certain indications, you will have to take recourse to CT and also MRI.
So the next question is there any scenario where TEE is preferred over TTE?
Transesophageal echocardiography, in the last 2 to 3 years, we've hardly used transesophageal echocardiography, except in a couple of occasions to actually demonstrate the quantum of mitral regurgitation and to rule out LA clot, because of the age, the comorbid conditions, and because of the cancer chemotherapy, the patient developed AFib, and there were chances of a stroke. So that's where we have used transesophageal echo.
Okay, so the next question is from Dr. Rosman. He's asking, may I do physical stress echo with pre and post GLPS with low ejection fraction? And is there any role of 3D echo?
If the ejection fraction is low, it may be a better idea to do actually a dobutamine stress echocardiography, because that will give you a good idea about viability and about contractile reserve. And it will also tell you how much the PA pressures are going up on therapy, and will give you a good idea of tissue Doppler imaging, about LVEDP. So that may be a better function. But yes, we do use dobutamine echo in these situations.
So the next question is from Dr. Himlata. She's actually put up a case there. She's saying that 70-year-old female post-op CA breast, taken 2 cycles of chemotherapy, is referred for cardiac assessment for further chemotherapy, transthoracic echo, shows good LV systolic function, normal GLS, but has severe calcification of aortic valve, right. AVA 1.0 centimeter square, meal PPG 35 mm of HG. What should be the approach of management of such patient?
I would take this patient at this point medically, because the mean gradient is still 35, and keep under good control with echocardiography, but let her or him complete the chemotherapeutic course or whatever drugs she's taking. And also, along with the EF, definitely do a global longitudinal strain. Here is a classical situation where you will be able to find out subclinical or preclinical LV dysfunction. Himlata is my senior from Sawai Mansingh Medical College, Jaipur, and we all call her Didi. So I know for sure. Yes.
So the next question is from Dr. Hussain. He's asking, is it necessary to do LV strain for all patients prior to a chemotherapy? Starting a chemotherapy.
Yes. We do it for every patient. For the simple reason is that that becomes our baseline. And from the baseline, if there was after 3 months or after 3 cycles or after 2 cycles, There was, if we can do another global longitudinal strain, we'll know if there is a preclinical ischemia already developing or not. So that's the only reason. Today, and that's exactly what, when the first case I showed you was exactly that, that ejection fraction is good, global longitudinal fraction, global longitudinal strain is actually even better. So I would, we do for every patient across the board, every patient has it.
So the next question is, in heart failure or cardiac dysfunction during treatment, should the chemotherapy be discontinued while commencing cardioprotective treatment?
Yes, absolutely. See, this is where the TEAM will come into function. That you will talk to your onco people, you will say, sir, give me a week, 10 days to actually get this patient out of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. I'm sure that's what he's talking about. And actually institute the therapy used for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. Once he has stabilized, the EF shows a trend towards improvement. Your NT-proBNP levels are coming down. Sometimes people also do troponin levels in these patients. Once they are showing a downward trend, then he can discuss with the patient and the oncology team and go ahead with the therapy. That's what I feel.
Perfect, sir. So the next question is around basics. It's like, is there any echo criteria for chemotherapy contraindications?
No, there are no criteria, but if the patient is in gross congestive heart failure, the ejection fraction is barely 30 or 35, it is heart failure with HFrEF, then nothing is absolute, but relatively, you will be very conscious of giving a drug which can further deteriorate the LV function. You'd definitely talk to your associates, your people on the oncology side and say, look, here is the situation. Patient is already in heart failure, LVEDP is elevated, the deacceleration slope is increased. Please give us an opportunity to treat first and then whatever drugs you have to give. Many times in our group, our people use to start with, after full decongestion, they start half the dose. They again see after a week or 10 days and then go incrementally. But yes, sometimes a patient's condition doesn't let you do that. So that's on a case-to-case basis. Nirmal?
The next question is from Dr. Majumdar. He's asking, role of endotracheal tube on the evaluation before chemotherapy.
Sorry, endotracheal tube?
Sorry, ETT. I mean, I thought this is, I don't think this is endotracheal. It's role of ETT on the evaluation before chemotherapy. I don't know. Yeah. ETT.
No, ETT is exercise treadmill testing. ETT. Well, if he wants to do an ETT, that's fine. But I would rather do a stress echocardiography, which will also tell me the functional status of the LV. It will also tell me the diastolic parameters. It will also tell me how much the PA pressures are going up. Yes, it's a good idea. But we actually, if not indication, we are doing a good transthoracic echo.
All right, so the next question is, how to differentiate between myxoma versus clots versus secondaries?
A myxoma is a myxoma. I mean, a myxoma is mostly seen in the across the mitral valve or the tricuspid valve. It has a fine consistency and it prolapses into the LV during diastole or goes into that. It has got, and you can also show if you do it carefully, a point with which it is attached to the interatrial septum. Metastases, I already showed you in one of the pictures on lung cancer. This could be of any shape, they could be attached anywhere, and they are generally quite mobile. And the thrombi, the most common places for a thrombi to actually be present is in the akinetic apex, generally, or the septum. So those are different things. But a LA myxoma, if you've seen one, or a RM Ixoma, the picture is characteristic, and you will never think that, because there is a point of attachment to the intraatrial septum, and you will see its movement with each cardiac cycle going in and out of the ILV or the RV cavity, and then coming back into the LA or the RV.
Perfect. So the next question is from Dr. Niranjan. He is asking how to manage pericardial effusion.
Just see, if it is not a tamponade, if it is just pericardial effusion, you can stop the chemotherapeutic agents temporarily, see how it goes, and then go ahead. You may use indomethacin or some other agents, but you have to make sure that this is as a result of the agents that you are being used and not because of congestive heart failure or because of any other concomitant disease. That's why I said you need to have a clinician on board who can look at all these things to its entirety. Anji?
Yes, the next question is, how do you approach a patient with normal LVF with reduced strain at the baseline?
Oh, so the global longitudinal strain is decreased. And yep. So here's the classical condition where before starting chemotherapeutic agents, you can look at the patient's heart rate, blood pressure, and actually start carvedilol in low doses or other agents, and to cardioprotect them later on. Because this is exactly what we see. We see that the ejection fractions are normal, but subclinically we are seeing that the global longitudinal strain is decreased. And then that's the reason why you should do it with the first. So then once you give the chemotherapeutic agents, you can easily see after a cycle or so, are you deteriorating it any further? Or is the patient taking it very well? So these are decisions which will go on an individual case-to-case basis. But this is the best point that has come out in the last, that the EF is normal, but the global longitudinal strain is decreased. This is exactly how we started our first line with.
Yes. So the next question is an extension to what you answered earlier as well. Is there any role of strain imaging in selecting patients for CRTD placement in heart failure?
Actually, no more. Actually, now people are going with on clinical grounds and with an ECG. But yes, we routinely do it just to see. Like, I would definitely like to see if my patients have actually got some cardiac reserve. If it's all fibrotic or if the cardiac tissue is greatly hampered. As also, now here is the utilization of MRI. If then the CRTD may not give him the full function. So that's what it is. Case to case basis, you'll have to go.
Sure. So the next comment or question is from Dr. Sharmila. She is PhD research scholar, and she's asking, at which stage of chemotherapy can we preferably do to stop spreading the cancer cells?
Well, that's a question she'll have to ask the oncologist. I'm only seeing the aftermath of the therapy. All I can say actually now, and this is in the realm of science still, is that we will be able to give targeted chemotherapy by echocardiography in the near future. That we'll be able to do.
And she's also asking, have you seen any asymptomatic case in your history?
Asymptomatic with what?
I think she meant the cancer asymptomatic something. She just mentioned that as an extension. Is there any asymptomatic case history you have come?
No, I'm, because I'm a cardiologist, I'm speaking from the heart side. Many people, of course, come with asymptomatic heart disease. And then we discover that they have a problem. But again, as I said, my principal thinking in this field is that the heart should not come in the way of the patient getting the treatment for which he or she actually came for. It should not be that, look, I came with a breast cancer, but look, here I am, I've got this disease. That's where our role comes in, of ameliorating at least our part so that our colleagues on the other side can go ahead full-fledged giving them the therapy. That's what I feel.
Perfect. So the next question is from Dr. Nishan. He's asking, how common is cancer-related amyloidosis in your experience, and what is the long-term prognosis?
It's not uncommon. Actually, I had one slide to show, but I didn't because of, I wanted to keep some time for this. There is a classical condition with amyloid. It's amyloid, when you do a global longitudinal strain, it's called cherry on top because every other area is non-functional, or the apical part seems to function. There is new therapy, transthyretin therapy are now available for amyloid patients, but you will have to do a good examination of the lymph nodes and maybe define it pathologically before you can start the therapy. The field of amyloid right now is buzzing with activity. Newer medications are there and we should take full use of it.
So the next question is from Andrianus. He's asking, when should we evaluate a cancer patient undergoing chemotherapy with TTE, transthoracic echo? At what stage?
But that's what this whole discussion has been, that we started before we do an echo, all the parameters before, during, and after. And for that, you will have to form a team. They will have to find out what kind of agent they are giving, how toxic it is to the myocardium, and accordingly you will make a schedule that these people will come after three cycles, these will come after the first cycle, these will don't have to bother at all. As I gave you the Mayo Clinic proceedings of 2014, very high risk, low risk, and very low risk. You will have to go accordingly. You have to have a plan at hand, and that's where a team comes into play.
Perfect, sir. So the next question is there any interference in GLS if the patient is already on beta blockers before and after chemotherapy?
No, interference, it's good. Maybe it will stop the beta blockers and other therapy, ACE inhibitors will stop the GLS from decreasing further.
Okay, so the next question is, when can cardioprotective medications be discontinued?
Why would you discontinue them? If they are helping him, keeping the ejection fraction, you're giving them in minimal doses, let him continue. And then over a period of time, that cannot be defined, you'll have to go person to person. You can say, yes, okay, now it's not no longer required. But I haven't come across such a situation. Generally, we do give a small dose of beta blocker throughout.
Perfect. So the last question that we have is there any role of diastolic stress echo in these cases?
Yes, diastolic heart function should be studied in every patient whom you are suspecting heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, HFpEF. If you have found HFpEF, then diastolic stress testing is the way to go. Because some of them may not have high NT-proBNP, they may look almost normal, but the minute you put them on a treadmill, the peer pressures will increase and the diastolic parameters will become abnormal. Good question.
So I have a very basic question here. Dr. Shamila is asking, how long chemotherapy will extend somebody's lifetime?
Yes.
That's a very hopeful question.
It's a very hopeful question, and it will depend from cancers to cancers and how early they started. But what I'm seeing in our own unit is that cancer chemotherapy applied well in time along with good cardio protection is giving them years to life much more than before. And I tell you, our team is doing a superb job in that. But individually, it will depend upon the kind of cancer. And it depends upon at what stage the people have come to you and what the PET scan shows. The initial PET scan is extremely important, that there were no secondaries. That's extremely important. Thank you.